Friends, now we'll see cholangiocarcinoma and gallbladder carcinoma. So these are two important malignancies arising from the biliary epithelium. So what are the risk factors for cholangiocarcinoma? So primary sclerosing cholangitis, presence of choledochal cyst or remnants of choledochal cyst which will be remaining after excision of choledochal cyst if it is not excised adequately will form a risk factor for cholangiocarcinoma. Presence of ulcerative colitis, Clonarchis sinensis infection. So any infestation caused by Clonarchis sinensis will form a predisposing factor for cholangiocarcinoma. Chronic typhoid carriers. So patients who are chronic typhoid carriers will be risk factors for developing cholangiocarcinoma. Hepatolithiasis. So patients having stones in their hepatic ducts will form a risk factor for cholangiocarcinoma. Biliary enteric anastomosis. Whenever you have anastomosis of biliary epithelium and intestinal epithelium, so they will predispose to the formation of cholangiocarcinoma at the site of anastomosis. Presence of liver fluke, dietary nitrosamines, exposure to thorotrast and dioxin will form risk factor for cholangiocarcinoma. So cholangiocarcinoma, they arise from biliary epithelium. Around 60% are located at the hepatic duct bifurcation, known as Klatskin tumors. So this is very commonly seen in cholangiocarcinoma. Most of them are located at the biliary confluence. The most common type of adenocarcinoma. So if you are asked question, which of the following malignancies are seen in cholangiocarcinoma, or which are the most following common types seen in cholangiocarcinoma, it is adenocarcinoma. They produce intense desmoplastic reaction with dense collagenous stroma. So most commonly the all fibrosis and adhesions and forming a big mass like thing, they are related to the dense desmoplastic reaction and dense collagenous stroma which is formed by these malignancies. As they do not synthesize bile, they never appear bile stain. So you may be asked question, on cut section of biliary tract malignancies of cholangiocarcinoma, they never appear bile stain. So why they not appear as bile stain? They may be giving various options, like they are not connected with biliary tree which is synthesizing bile, or they may be giving option like they do not synthesize bile, which is the correct option. So most of the biliary tract malignancies of cholangiocarcinoma, they can be classified by bismuth correlate classification. Biliary tree with hepatic ducts, common hepatic duct, gallbladder and common bile duct. So type 1 tumors are confined to the common hepatic duct. So when your tumors are confined to this segment, these are type 1 tumors. When your tumors involve bifurcation without involvement of secondary intrahepatic ducts, these are type 2. So whenever the confluence is involved, they are type 2. And type 3A and 3B depict whether there is extension along the right hepatic duct or left hepatic duct, they form type A and B respectively. So when the tumors involve both these ducts along with the common hepatic duct portion, they form type 4 tumors. So you may be asked question, which of the tumors have involvement of bile duct confluence? So these are not type 1 tumors. The type 2 tumors onwards, they have involvement of the bifurcation. Painless jaundice is the most common presentation. Pruritus, mild right upper quadrant pain, anorexia, fatigue, weight loss may be present along with cholangitis. So whenever there is cholangiocarcinoma along with obstruction of the duct, patient may be having symptoms of cholangitis. Surgical resection is the only treatment, but most of them are non-operable at the presentation. So as the tumors have got very insidious presentation, so patient presents to you with very late stage, so they cannot be offered curative resection. Percutaneous transhepatic cholangiocatheter placement is a choice of palliative procedure done in them. So whenever there is obstruction and you cannot get above the obstruction for relieving of the bile flow, so PTC is the choice of procedure which is done to divert bile from liver. So friends, we have seen cholangiocarcinoma, which are the most common types and what are the risk factors and the treatment options. Now we will see second entity of malignancy, which is gallbladder malignancies. So these are tumors arising from the gallbladder. So what are the risk factors for gallbladder malignancies? The risk factors for gallbladder malignancies, these are gallstones, adenomatous polyps, if the polyps are more than 10 mm. So you may be asked various questions on this. So which of the following are risk factors for gallbladder malignancy? So adenomatous polyps, if they are more than 10 mm, they form very important risk factor. Calcified or porcelain gallbladder, so if the gallbladder wall is calcified or it appears on x-ray as a porcelain gallbladder, then it will be malignancy predominant condition. So patients may be harboring malignancy, so they form an indication for cholecystectomy. Presence of choledochal cyst, presence of sclerosing cholangitis, presence of anomalous pancreaticobiliary duct junction, then exposure to carcinogens like azotolamine and nitrosamines, they form more of the risk factors for gallbladder malignancies. Friends, now we'll see pathology of the gallbladder malignancy. Adenocarcinoma is the commonest type of malignancy associated with gallstones. So this is a very important statement. You may be asked question, which of the following malignancies are associated with gallbladder carcinoma? So they may be giving options like adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, various other types of malignancies like transition cell carcinoma, for diverting you. But the type of correct answer is adenocarcinoma. And friends, it is also seen commonly with gallstones. So adenocarcinoma is seen most commonly which of the conditions? You may be asked other way around, like they may give an option like gallstones and other types of gallbladder pathologies. It is gallstones. So adenocarcinoma mostly seen with gallstones. Cancer of the gallbladder spreads through lymphatics with venous drainage and with direct invasion into the liver pericava. So as the location of the gallbladder is situated below the liver, the spread may be occurring through lymphatics, venous channel, or direct spread to the liver bed. Lymphatic flow from gallbladder drains first to the cystic duct nodes, then to the pericholecystal and hilar nodes, and finally the peripancreatic, duodenal, periporter, celiac, and supramesenteric artery nodes. This is very important because you may be asked question, which of the following forms the correct sequence of spread of malignancy from gallbladder to the higher nodes. So don't forget this sequence. So they may be giving you four choice of answers, altering the sequence, or they may be omitting some of the node stations. So this is forming the correct sequence. Gallbladder veins directly drain into adjacent liver, usually segment 4 and segment 5. The gallbladder wall differs histologically from intestines in that it lacks muscularis mucosa and submucosa. This is very important because in intestines or any of the small bowel, you will see mucosa, submucosa, then muscularis propria and serosa. These are the four layers. But the gallbladder differs in that it will lack muscularis mucosa and submucosa. So muscularis mucosa is the part of mucosa. It comes the last stage. Mucosa is made up of three components. So muscularis mucosa is the last component of the mucosa, and next to mucosa there is submucosa. So these two components, they are lacking in gallbladder. So friends, we have seen earlier in esophagus and stomach that lymphatics of all these like small intestine, they are placed in submucosa. So whenever there is spread of tumor to the submucosa, they will in fact endanger that part of bowel wall to spread to the lymphatics. But as the mucosa and muscularis mucosa and submucosa is absent, the histologically it is different from the intestines, and gallbladder wall has got specific arrangement in form this. So the lymphatics are present in subserosal form. So mucosa is having lack in the muscularis mucosa and submucosa is absent. So lymphatics are present in the subserosal layer. So as to other forms in the small intestine where the lymphatics are present in submucosa, in gallbladder the lymphatics are present in subserosal layer. So when you do not have the transmission to the lymph nodes unless until the tumor cells reach the lymphatic plexuses, which are present in the subserosal layer. So whenever there is crossing of the tumor across the mucosa, that is muscularis propria, into subserosal layer, then only the spread to the lymph node occurs. So this will form the very important basic understanding of treatment of gallbladder malignancies. So if you have got tumor which will be crossing muscularis propria and reaching the subserosal layer, then only it will have more chances of spread to the lymph nodes. So cancers invading but growing through the muscular layer have minimal risk of nodal disease. So whenever there is crossing of the muscularis propria, these tumors should be treated in different way. What are the clinical manifestations and how do you diagnose? They are generally indistinguishable from those associated with cholecystitis and cholelithiasis, abdominal discomfort, right upper quadrant pain, nausea and vomiting. These are most common presentation. Jaundice, weight loss, anorexia, in later stages presence of ascites and abdominal mass, they are less common presenting symptoms. Ultrasonography will often reveal a thickened, irregular gallbladder wall or mass replacing gallbladder. Ultrasonography may visualize tumor invasion of the liver, lymphadenopathy and dilated biliary tree. The sensitivity of ultrasonography in detecting gallbladder cancer ranges from 70 to 100%. CT scan may demonstrate gallbladder mass or invasion into adjacent organs. Friends, we saw CT scan and ultrasonography, they may give you diagnosis, but the mainstay of diagnosis will remain the MRI. MRI will show various non-invasive modalities, like it will show complete assessment of biliary, vascular, nodal, hepatic and adjacent organ involvement. So MRI will replace all other investigations, will give you answers to all of your questions like presence of nodal status and various adjacent organ involvement. How do you treat gallbladder malignancies? Surgery remains the only curative option for gallbladder cancer as well as cholangiocarcinoma. Palliative procedures are commonly done for patients with unresectable cancer and jaundice or duodenal obstruction. Palliative procedures are most commonly performed surgeries for gallbladder cancers. So friends, when your patient presents to you in delayed stage, palliative procedures are the commonly done surgeries for gallbladder cancer. So you may be asked questions, which of the following surgeries are done most commonly for gallbladder malignancies? So these are palliative procedures. So simple cholecystectomy is adequate for treatment for T1 lesions. So T1 lesions are tumors limited to the muscular layer of gallbladder. So earlier in pathophysiology we saw the tumors which do not cause muscular layer have less chance of spread to the nodular disease. So if you have got tumor which are T1 lesions, we are restricted proximal to the muscularis propria, the cholecystectomy alone will form the curative treatment. So in which situations or in which T lesions cholecystectomy alone is curative, if you are asked question, they are T1 lesions. So this is very important, you may be asked question on this. When tumor invades perimuscular connective tissue without extension beyond serosa or into liver, these are called T2 tumors and extended cholecystectomy is done. So whenever there is tumor which will be crossing muscularis propria into subserosal layer, they will have to be treated differently by extended cholecystectomy. So we'll see now what is extended cholecystectomy. Extended cholecystectomy includes resection of liver segments 4B and 5 and lymphadenectomy of cystic duct along with pericholecystectomy, portal and right celiac and posterior pancreaticoduodenal lymph node excision. So you may be asked question on this, which of the following does not form component of extended cholecystectomy? So they will give you options like resection of right lobe of liver and all the things which are not specific to above segment. So exact answer of extended cholecystectomy is given by above statement. For tumors which will grow beyond serosa or invade the liver or other organs, these are T3 and T4 lesions, they should be treated with complete tumor excision with extended right hepatectomy, like removal of segment 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. Should be done for adequate tumor clearance. But these things only can be done after you have ruled out distant liver metastasis. So they should not be having metastasis to the other lobe of liver or any other intraperitoneal visceral organs. So friends, we saw gallbladder carcinoma and treatment of cholangiocarcinoma. So gallbladder carcinoma, we saw various risk factors for the gallbladder carcinoma and various pathological stages of gallbladder carcinoma, T1, T2, T3 and T4, and their various pathological arrangement in form of various presence of submucosal lymphatic plexus which is absent in gallbladder and spread to the various organs and the treatment of the gallbladder carcinoma. Thank you.